explained that our regular technical guy is out sick, and so Jeremy, mostly Jeremy, a little bit of Pastor, have been trying to punt and get everything accomplished. It may not be all in the order that we would desire, but it's all there. Amen. So, I didn't practice this beforehand, but good morning. Same thing from last week, right? Look at the person beside you and say, I'm glad you came to church.
I'm glad you came to church.
All right. Guten Morgen, sind Sie die Person neben sich? Und sagen Sie, ich bin so froh, dass Sie heute in die Kirche gekommen sind. Ah, that's I'm not going to murder yours today. Well, I am going to murder you today. You ready? Una demoniata prevista persona de langa tine spune sunt ata de pucuros chia ai vini la vestidica. But I'm stopping if you're laughing that hard. Must have been really bad. Let's do announcements. This afternoon, I'll give you a second to get over your laughing. Hey, I tried.
Yeah,
that's pretty, it must be pretty bad if Miss Curry's laughing that bad. All right, so Damaris, you got to give me some lessons.
It sounded good to us non-Romanians.
Yes.
Well, apparently it did sound pretty comical to Tori. All right, so, and I didn't do any Hungarian, I'm sorry. We'll try next week, all right? So this afternoon at 4:30 is Man Church, and I want everybody that is a male that can go to the bathroom by themselves to come, amen. I don't want to do any diapers is what I'm getting at, amen. So we're going to do the missions giving, taking those up this week, but I'm going to postpone that one more week. We do have a youth event, which is ages 10 to 19 on the 15th of April, which is Good Friday. That's 2 weeks from April 1st, basically, which is a couple days ago. A week from this coming Friday, and that's at 7 p.m. or 1900. You're going to build your own pizza, and then there's some games, and Brother Phil is going to do an Easter message for y'all. And then we have a children's event on 16 April from 10 to 12. We're going to do an Easter egg hunt. Newsflash, Easter eggs have nothing to do with Easter, but before they hunt Easter eggs, Denise is going to sing some songs with them and tell the biblical and correct Easter story before they get to the candy and the eggs, amen. Won't be any hope for it after the candy and the eggs. We do have an upcoming ladies event at Rhineland Baptist. My wife is one of the speakers. Everyone is welcome at the table. It's the theme, and it's a Europe-wide ladies retreat from May 5th to 7th. So if you haven't registered, you can do so at rhinelandbaptist.net. Now they tell me my lovely daughter is going to sit. can't expect to live in this life and not have difficulties. But I am thankful. I bet I'm not the only one in the room that had some difficulties this week. In fact, mine may be minimal compared to your own. But if you know Christ, He's with you.
Amen.
Through the good times, through the bad times, through the hard times, and through the easy times. We generally start each week with a message for the children. So we've been talking about Christ from the cradle to the cross. Basically, we actually started with creation, so we could say this has been from the creation to the cross thus far. About noon on the day that Christ was crucified, strange things began to happen. Big black clouds rolled in till the sky was almost black. There was thunder and lightning. The ground began to quiver and shake. Most people ran back to the city of Jerusalem for shelter. From noon until 3 on the day of the crucifixion, that darkness continued. Really, something wonderful was happening. The greatest thing that had ever happened until that point, and possibly in all eternity, happened. All the things that you and I had done wrong, all of our sins, were placed on Christ. God the Father in heaven looked at God the Son on the cross and saw our sins. God the Father hates sin, and so He would not look, and therefore the sky was blackened. He poured out all His anger and all His wrath upon Christ Jesus. Jesus took our eternal punishment in those few hours. It was so bad that God didn't want all mankind to see it, so He draped the earth with clouds and darkness. At 3 p.m., Jesus lifted His head and said, "It is finished." Everything that needed to be done for us to go to heaven was finished. And He bowed His head and gave up the ghost. He had finished taking all of our punishment. The clouds rolled away. Things kind of returned to normalcy. But one soldier looked up and said something to the effect of, "I think we just crucified the Son of God and didn't realize it." Those soldiers remembered the next day was an important Sabbath. And since it was against the Jews' religion to have dead bodies up on the Sabbath, they came by to break the legs of the men on the cross. You see, the cross was a very vicious way to die, but they typically died from asphyxiation. They had to push themselves up to get a breath, and so then with damaging the legs, they were no longer able to breathe. But when they came to Christ, they realized He was already dead, because nobody took His life. He willingly gave it up. They pierced His side to be sure He was dead, and out came the water or the pericardial fluid and blood. His body was removed and put in a tomb. But 3 days later, He came back to life, and 40 days after that event, He raised to heaven and is sitting at the right hand of the Father. And we can live in heaven with Him when we die. In fact, we not only can, that's why He went to the cross, was to provide us a place. If you believe that you're a sinner and that Jesus, as God in the flesh, took your sins, you can trust Him as your Savior right now. Normally, this is just for the children, but I'm going to ask everybody in the room to bow your heads for just a second. Close your eyes. 8 to 94. If you're here this morning, 56 to 94. If you're alive this morning, you can understand what I'm saying, and you want to trust Christ as your Savior right now, I'm going to ask you to look at me. Let me rephrase the question. If you are not sure that you've already trusted Christ, and you want to trust Christ right now, for the first time, or for the only time, I want you to look at me. All right? I saw one person when I rephrased the question who looked at me. So the ladies and Finn are going to lead us in a song. We're going to all stand, and I'm going to go to the back. If you understood the question and you would like to know for sure right now that you have a home in heaven, that one person, I'm going to ask you to meet me in the foyer. Go ahead. I'll stand for the song.
Thank you.
have had to kind of adapt on how to get that up there. I mean, that's why you see my phone. But let's all stand, and what is our next song?
Count Your Many Blessings. Facing a bear or a lion or a wolf, because most of those predators have been eradicated, except in a few areas like in the north central part of the United States and maybe out towards Alaska. For most people today, hunting is just a hobby. If you think about it, you've probably seen a sign, a shirt, or a bumper sticker about either hunting or fishing that says, a bad day in the stand is better than a good day at work. Amen. All right? But historically, people had to hunt. If they failed in their quarry, their families would suffer greatly. The hunt provided leather for tools and clothes. It provided meat for the family, fat for both cooking and healing. I don't really understand, but I'm told that bear fat or pork fat was used like an antibacterial ointment. In search of game, men had to brave the cold, the rain, the snow, the heat sometimes. They had to hunt predators not only for food, but to protect their livestock and their families. They hunted the ruminant, not only to eat, but to sell both the meat and the hide. If you have a $10 bill, what is slang for a $10 bill? A saw buck. What else is it? The word buck is where I'm going. Why do we call dollars bucks? It goes back to hunting. And a deer hide in the colonial days, or maybe just after the colonial days, was worth $1. Or $1. So $1 got you $1. And so then that part of American language anyway has lasted all of these years because it traces its heritage back to hunting. These men faced natural dangers like rock slides, river crossings without a boat or a bridge. So what's the practical lesson? Well, first off, there's really no need to face danger. Let me rephrase that. It is not necessary to face danger just because. But when it must be faced, we should face it bravely. There's a scripture in the New Testament, "Quit yourselves like men." Now, a few years ago, there were signs all over the United States on cars and trucks and stuff, and it said, "No fear." Now, that was an allusion, Cecile, to the 23rd Psalm, right? Mm-hmm. "I will fear no evil." But then, a lot of rednecks changed it, and you see this on the front of the truck that said, "Ain't scared." All right? He who fears nothing is a fool. You cannot be brave without fear. Fear is overcoming, bravery is overcoming your fear. So, what is the lesson for us? The person who fears nothing is a fool. The person who fears most or everything is a coward. The valiant man who dares what he must and fears only what he ought is Christ-like, at least in that aspect. The Bible says, "Watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men, and be strong." You're going to face fears in life. I faced some this week. You probably faced some this week. Some of us want to run away from the fear. There is fear in, we just watched the missionary video. Help me, Lord, I don't want to go off forever. We have hundreds of these in the foyer there. This is an accurate explanation of what it is to be saved. And it's a fearful thing to hand that to somebody. You can say it's not, but the proof that there's still hundreds in the foyer says there's some fear in it. "But quit you like men, be strong." You can hand this one to anybody, German or English speaking, because it is God's simple plan of salvation in German and English. Now, this is only English. It has the plan of salvation on the back. You could leave that with the waiter. Leave that with somebody who's waiting on you. Most people around here speak English. They just say it isn't it when you ask them if they speak English, right? But it is a fearful thing to be the witness God called us to be. And yet, if we're going to see, well, you know, that man didn't accomplish that in a year. He's been there 23 years, all those big classes and those big meetings. It takes work. And not just work by the pastor, but work by the people. Let's all stand. What's your next number or song?
It's Wired and Snow, page 361 in the magazine. And we'll do all four verses.
Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now
Yes, how about we do that in Icelandic?
O Herra minn Jesus, ég hrópa þig á, því hjarta mitt brennur að guðlegri hjá. Brjót mínur fer skerð og þeir skala mér bjó, og þó mig svo verði ég hvítar í snjó. Hvítar í snjó, já, hvítar í snjó, og þó mig svo verði ég hvítar í snjó.
Man, I barely got English down, so I'll get up here and sing something to you. It wouldn't sound that good. Folks, even though we have problems during the week, it's still a wonderful week. We're still Amen. Above ground. We still worship God. Come to church on Sunday, and that's just an awesome thing that we're about to do, and I praise God for that. And I praise God to see all y'all here this morning. It's awesome. So we're going to look at the things that we need to pray for, as always, for church growth, and spiritually, numerically. We need to truly get on hands and knees and prostrate ourselves before the Lord and pray that we see a healing in our nation, see that we heal it, see a growth in our church. Pray for our leaders, man, economic situations, Ukraine. There's just a lot of things going on in our world today. A lot of things here in Europe that, it is, as we start looking, anybody watch the news, and I don't watch German news, I can't get German news, but I do watch AFN, and I see a lot of things shaping up, and hopefully things are going to calm down. I pray to God.
Amen.
We need to pray for marriage, reconciliation, and strength. You know, the bond that the Bible talks about the most, if you think about it, and it refers to Jesus as well in the church, is the bond of marriage, the marriage supper of the Lamb, the bride of Christ. And we need to pray for marriages. We need to pray for strengthened marriages, for reconciliations. If Satan can take one thing apart that will affect the church the most, I believe marriages is that thing. Because if he can turn two people who love each other against each other, he can do just about anything. We need to pray for the jobs. There's a few of us here that have a lot of, and I see a couple of our military folks are out this morning, so, you know, pray for them. Some of them have a little bit of a high stress situation. Some of them it's getting more and more. Let's pray for, there's a lot of unspoken requests that the people ask that you pray, but they're not, it's close enough to their heart that they don't really want to give you what's going on. Backslidden and lost friends, wow. Man, there's a lot of them out there. So we need to pray and pray for as many people, and we just need to be in prayer more, and for the more people, the things that come to your mind. And I guarantee you, if you sit down and start praying, things will come to your mind during that prayer that might not otherwise. And if you think about that happens all the time. And, you sit there and you think, God, what do you want me to pray about? Well, there's a lot of things. You know, I mean, we need to pray for Dan and Andrew are out this morning sick. For health, for Shaley Martinez, Michaela, and Rainier Lunk and the skin problems. Inga and Eric, Eileen and Phil, and John and Lamb, and just a lot of different health issues. And we know that God is a master physician, that Jesus is the doctor of all. Okay. We need to pray for Carolyn's Moore's friend who's got cancer, facing cancer, and Joe's mom. We need to pray for revival meetings in Springwood, Mississippi, and April, the Community Baptist Church in Alabama, with a prayer for faithful Anthony Norris in his 40s to take the place of the aging pastor, Chuck Ford. Jennifer, who's taking custody of small relatives, is that what that is?
Yeah, it's Sham's friend who came the other week. Mm-hmm. And, in a lot of cases in the States, I don't know about here in Germany, but parents fail at parenting, and then another relative is asked, the
effectively by the government to take custody of these children, and that's the situation.
Okay. Need to pray for that in Southside Baptist.
In Florida, they're in the midst of, they're not in the midst of a protracted meeting. Mm-hmm. They're actually seeing people saved every day for about a week now.
Wow. And you know what? We need to pray about a revival here in our church. What do we need to do to bring the lost in, to revive our people, the people that are healed. And we don't want to be treading water as a church. We want to be swimming hard for the Lord. And I think that's the main thing that we need to look at doing, is that it. And I don't want you to work for work's sake. We want to work for the church, for the Lord's sake, to see people come and know the Lord. Let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, you are such an awesome God that we pray to. You are such a forgiving God for all the things that I've done so wrong and so many times that you forgive me for. And Lord, when I even let my mind wander, and to even these days, as things are distracting us from our godly walk, Father, I pray that this church walks directly in the path that you want them to be. Father, I pray for revival in the church and our country and our land. I pray for the sick, that you heal the sick. Father, I pray that is the marriages, Father. There are so many people that struggle, and it seems like, Lord, people give up so easily nowadays. Help us to remember that Jesus died for those marriages. Jesus died for us. And Father, just lead us the direction. Help us to be able to listen to you and follow you. Let's not get ahead of Jesus, of you, God. Let's listen here and see what you want us to do, Father. In each of our own lives, by praying and asking you for direction, and in the body of the church, as we come together as a church, leading the direction that this church needs to go. Father, I know that we'll give you praise and glory for everything that happens, but help us to do it on a daily basis and watch after you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. One thing I failed to mention and failed to put it on the prayer request is that I bumped into a young man yesterday, and I might not get the unit right. I think he said the 721st. Is there such a unit? Anyway, he deployed today. He was spending time with his kids yesterday because he deployed today. Do you have one more congregation? Am I wrong?
Yes.
Okay. So let's all stand and sing this last congregation, and then Joe will come forward.
In the hymnal.
Our sins and griefs to bear.
may be seated. As Joe comes forward,
I want to kind of quote to you Exodus 35:5. It says, "Take ye an offering unto the Lord, whosoever is of a willing heart." This is for believers. This is for members of the church, not for visitors. But it's also not to be done grudgingly. It's to be done out of love and honor for the Lord. Joe, you want to lead us in prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, I really glorify and really praise you that you gave that you gave the best of all gifts, your only begotten Son, to forgive us our sins and to rescue us forever. Jesus, we pray. Please bless the offering.
Amen. The plate must be back there. So,
it's kind of a problem.
It's all right. You go ahead and play, and he'll go get it and come back. They've sung this before. They want you to sing with them if you can. So we gotta get our mic squared away. Might take
some.
She's
purple.
Got brown and purple, she said.
Test them out.
Testing.
Her to try another.
Do you want the wireless? I can get the wireless. Yeah.
We're having color issues. That's all.
Get the wireless. She's gonna get the wireless.
It's on.
Go ahead.
It's on. Is it on?
Hello, Justin.
It's on.
Okay.
Thank you.
another day. Amen. You know, when you have a job and you can't help being sick, but when you have a job and everybody depends on you to do a job and you're out sick, boy, it leaves a hole. And I'm real thankful for Jeremy, and he really was over here for absolutely hours yesterday trying to put this thing together, and was here early this morning, and I was trying to help him. That's probably the problem right there, between Sunday school and church and before Sunday school. But so I'm sorry the words weren't there, but we did the best we could, and hopefully you enjoyed the song. I know it blesses my heart because we do serve a holy God. Mm-hmm. We are in Matthew chapter 5. I'm going to have Damaris and Joe read with us in a moment. We're going to read about three verses of Scripture. But I kind of want to review as to what we covered the last few weeks, because maybe everybody hadn't been here. So we have covered so far six. We call them the Beatitudes because they're all about being, right? Blessed are the poor. Are is a to be verb. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are they that mourn. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are they that do hunger and thirst after righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure. And today we will start with blessed are the peacemakers. And we will go down to verse 12. So that will be 1, 2, 3, 4 verses, not 3. But anyway, these Beatitudes have an application for the man, woman, the boy, the girl who wishes to be saved, at least poor in spirit, mourning, and hungering do. But they also have an application for the believer. The lost have to lose all confidence in their flesh, right? Therefore, they're poor in spirit. They're not arrogant. They must mourn the fact that they have neither spiritual food nor spiritual clothing, nor means to obtain them. Thus, they are mourning. They hunger not for their own righteousness, but for Christ's righteousness. They've realized that all of our righteousness, Isaiah writes, is as filthy rags, and therefore they wish to be filled with His or Christ's righteousness. But all those also have an application for us, the believers, as well. As meek, merciful, and pure. Poor in spirit. It's not about me. It's not about John. It's not about Joe. It's about Jesus. So poor in spirit. Mourning my sin and the sin of my people. Phil hit on this when he was going through the prayer request this morning. And sometimes, you know, when we pray, we don't necessarily... Help me, Lord. We don't... Well, let's just put it like this, Jeremy. Everything we do, we want, at least in the Western world, in Europe and the United States, we want to do it in a microwave fashion. We want to do it, you know, used to, you had to cook a pizza. Well, it's going to take you, you know, 30 minutes. If it's a pre-made pizza that's frozen, you put it in the oven, it's going to take you 30 minutes. But my boys that are now 19 and 21 have figured out how to cook it in a microwave in about 5 minutes, and they can tell you down to the second of how long it takes to get it done. And that's the way we treat everything in life, including our Bible reading, and as we're mentioning right now, our prayer life. We want to do it quickly. But I want you to listen to a true prayer, not only for this man, as far as we can tell, was right with God because he saw the burden of his people. Listen to this prayer, okay? It is in Nehemiah chapter 1, and it came to pass when I heard these words, this is Nehemiah talking, that I sat down and wept. And mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And I said, so there's the prayer. I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let thine ear now be attentive and thine eyes be open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now day and night. Day and night. This is not a 5-minute prayer. It's going to take me probably 3 minutes just to read this one prayer. But this is something that the Holy Spirit of God inspired to be recorded, that he prayed this prayer over and over and over and over and over, day and night. For the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned. Notice he put himself in the group. We want to talk about in church all those people out there, but Nehemiah put himself in the group with his people. We have sinned against thee.
Both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept thy commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgments which thou commandest thy servant Moses. Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if ye turn to me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out unto the uttermost part of heaven, yet will I gather them from thence, and will bring them unto the place that I have chosen and set my name there. Now these are thy servants and thy people whom thou hast redeemed, and by thy great power and by thy strong hand, O Lord God, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive. Let your ear listen to the prayer of thy servant and to the prayer of thy servants, the fellow people praying with him, who desire to fear thy name and prosper. I pray thee, thy servant, this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man. That's not a short prayer. It's not a microwave prayer. When he prayed for the sins of his people, he was very precise. So this whole morning, it has an application for us. And hungering and thirsting to be filled with his righteousness. Sometimes we as Christians forget that we're not saved by what we do. I have heard people in church say almost word for word. They don't do it word for word because then they would actually be convicted, right? Where the old Pharisee, he prays, Lord, I thank thee that I'm not like this fella here. And he begins to name that guy's sin. And then he begins to talk about his righteousness. That's not what we're talking about. But I have heard people in church talk about other people who are not in church or who used to be in church as if they were so much, the person in church was so much better than the person who was not where they needed to be. That's not the way we pray. We pray with a broken heart for our sin. Look, there's not a lot of people in the room maybe there are more than I realize, who have grown children. You think for a moment. There's no perfect child, except for Emma. But there's no perfect child. I'm kidding, obviously. There's no perfect child. And when that child, especially when a grown child, does something that hurts you, think how heartbreaking that is. And sometimes you don't even know what or how to say it. When you pray, if you think of that, that's the way the Lord feels when we don't do what he's called us to do. We hunger and thirst after his righteousness. We mourn for the sin of our sin. We're talking about how this applies to us as believers. Meek, you're powerful, but controlled by the Holy Spirit. Merciful. I actually put the wrong verse last week. I put Ephesians 4:29. It's Ephesians 4:32. And be ye kind, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, have forgiven you. Well, it's easy to get annoyed with people who do us wrong, but we are commanded as believers to forgive them like Christ forgave us. Christ forgave us, as I understand the scriptures, while he was on the cross. Now, I didn't get benefit of that forgiveness, Logan, until July 13th, 1978, when I said, Lord, save me. But the forgiveness was there waiting on me. So I'm not saying somebody's done you wrong. There are people in here that have broken homes and all sorts of things that they're facing. Some people in the room may work for a corrupt boss. I mean, I don't know all the different things that you could be facing. But I'm not telling you that you have to embrace these people who've hurt you with open arms. But I am telling you the scripture says we are to forgive them the same way Christ forgave us. and he didn't give a list of demands. Isn't that good? He didn't give a list of demands. Well, you do this, and you do the other, and maybe I'll save you. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. He said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. Even between Palm Sunday and Easter of 1978. That's when Job got saved.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter what we've done. He forgives us. Pure. Being made pure. Declared innocent and clean by God because he accepts the payment for my sin made by the Christ I call Lord. Today, I believe we will finish the Beatitudes. All that was review. We're going to try to get to a sermon now. Joe, are you in Matthew chapter 5?
Yes.
Damaris, are you in Matthew chapter 5?
Yes.
We're going to read verses 9 to 12. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Joe?
Cindy, preach Vatican, then see when God's kid dies.
Damaris? Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Joe?
And selig sind, die um der Gerechtigkeit willen verfolgt werden, denn das ist, denn das Himmelreich ist ihr.
A little louder, Damaris. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Joe?
Beseelig seid ihr, wenn euch die Menschen um meines Willen schmähen und verfolgen und reden allerlei Übles. Wieder euch so sie daran lügen.
Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Verse 12.
So seid ihr fröhlich und getrost, wird euch im Himmel wohl belohnt werden, denn also haben sie verfolgt die Propheten und die vor euch gewesen sind.
Okay, so you have four things here. You got four verses, and you really have four things. You have peacemakers, you have the persecuted, and then another word for speak is propaganda. So the propagandized and the pampered. Peacemakers, persecuted, propagandized, and pampered. Peacemakers. As with the others, there's a twofold application, but here the application is only for a believer. And the first way that you as a believer, that I as a believer, should be a peacemaker is to be an evangelist, okay? To tell people about Jesus. The evangel is a Latin-based word for gospel. Evangel, gospel. Those words are synonymous in English. They mean the same thing. They mean glad tidings. And Jesus in Isaiah chapter 9 is called the Prince of Peace. So when I share with someone how to be saved, how to know that they have eternal life, I am giving them at least the opportunity to have peace with God. All right? John 16:33, Jesus said, "These things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation." That's what we talked about earlier, right? All of us have tribulation. But be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. So as an evangelist, when we tell somebody how to be saved, we are sharing with them peace. In Matthew 18, you are commanded. In Matthew 18, Mark 16, and Luke 24, and John chapter 20, and in Acts chapter 1, those of us who have called on Christ as our Lord are commanded to be evangelists. He said, all power is given unto me. In other words, all authority, all jurisdiction is given unto him. So on his jurisdiction, on his authority, on his power, I am to go unto every, there in Matthew it says, go ye into all nations. That's every people group. Okay? In Mark, it says, go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That doesn't mean I speak to the kangaroos and the elephants so they make all the big holes all over the earth, Joe was telling before church, right? That doesn't mean I go preach to the chickens. That doesn't mean I preach the gospel to Chrissy and Boone, our dogs. No, that means I preach the gospel to everybody, whether I like them, whether I don't, whether they look like me, whether they speak like me. I try to give the gospel to every person of every people. In Luke, it tells us how. It says that repentance and remission should be preached in his name, beginning at Jerusalem. In other words, I'm not telling somebody, you got to do this to be saved, you got to do that to be saved. You have to believe and you have to call, and that is all you have to do. And if you do that, if I truly believe and I truly call on him, then repentance will be obvious in my life. What is repentance? Well, I'm old. I don't know if I can do an about face anymore. But repentance is an about face. You were on the road to hell and you have turned and agreed with God and now you're on the road to heaven. It will be obvious to believers and unbelievers that there is something different about you. And that is what we are to preach to people. And in John 20, it's his passion. None of us here are I can't take five sardines it's two sardines and five biscuits, five loaves and two fishes, right? Two sardines and five biscuits and feed Megan, but Christ did. Huh? I can't walk on water, but Christ did. I can't say to the snow, for my kids' benefit, stay. Or for your benefit, leave. But Christ can. So when he said, as the Father sent me, I'm not born of a virgin. And I'm not sinless. I make mistakes. Sometimes I lose my temper. Sometimes I eat too much. Kind of obvious, right? Especially when I turn sideways. So how am I sent like Christ was sent? He said, the first commandment is to love the Lord. And the second is to love my neighbor. And he basically defined for you that your neighbor is any living human being. So I'm sent forth in his passion. And if I'm in his passion, I have found, people don't always agree with what you have to say, but I have found in 26 years of ministry, if they know two things, Logan, if they know you love Jesus and they know you love them, they will at least listen. They may not embrace it, but they will at least listen. We are peacemakers when we share the gospel of peace with people. And then there's also arbitrator. Okay, an evangelist and an arbitrator. Everybody was scared of Saul when he got saved. Why were they scared of Saul? Joe, tell us why everyone should have been scared, was reasonably scared of Saul, whom we know as Paul, when he got saved, when he first got saved. Why were they scared of him?
Because he before that, he persecuted and imprisoned and murdered the Christians.
Exactly. This guy held the coats of those people who stoned Stephen to death, with Stephen praying much like Christ, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Paul was holding the coats. When Paul got saved, he was on the way to Damascus to persecute believers and imprison them. Mm-hmm. Barnabas went to find him to have arbitration, see if he's really saved, and if he's really saved, to make peace between him and the other Christians. And I think Scripture proves that he was successful in that. You can make peace between other believers. More so than just other believers, Romans 12:18 says, as much, if it be possible, as much that lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Now, some people won't let you live peaceable with them, but there's far fewer of those than you and I want to act like. Peacemakers, as believers, when we are evangelists, when we are arbitrators, we are peacemakers. Then you look at that next verse there, verse number 10, it says, blessed are they which are persecuted. But there is a caveat. I have a friend. He comes from a different denomination than I do. But he is oftentimes asking me to pray for him or some friend or some family member because they're being persecuted. But they're being persecuted typically, I know this guy real well, because they have done something to warrant these other people's anger. Okay? In other words, they're reaping what they've sown. There is a caveat in Scripture. It doesn't say you're blessed when you're persecuted. It says when you're persecuted. Look at that. It's in parentheses right there. It's in quotations right there. For righteousness' sake. If they are persecuting you, Otis, because you love Jesus, because you invite them to church, because you tell them they need to be saved, then there's unbelievable joy in that. But when you're being persecuted because you did something against that person, there is no joy in that persecution. Okay? The scriptures to back that up. Jesus said, remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours. People, not everybody is going to accept Christ. Even some people who claim to be Christians won't accept you. If you go to John 6:66, it's one of the most alarming verses in Scripture. Many of his disciples, many people who claim to follow Christ, you ready? Turned and walked no more with them. So they professed to have repented, but then they went ahead and repented and went back where they came from. Not everybody that you witness to is going to embrace the witness. If they didn't listen to Christ, they're not going to listen to you. Some people are going to persecute you. If they're persecuting you because of your righteous life, it's okay. 2 Timothy 3:12, yea, and all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Now, that doesn't mean that they're going to put you on the chopping block like they did Paul. I am reminded at this moment of a Polish Christian that I never personally met, but he was a Baptist pastor in Poland when the communists were still in control. And a friend of mine who at one time, I've lost contact with a friend, I don't know where he's at today, but at one time he was a missionary there in Poland. And he said to the young missionary, he said, you know, behind the Iron Curtain, I saw hundreds face imprisonment and possible death for the name of Christ. And I did not see one fall to that temptation to deny Christ. But since the Iron Curtain fell, what was that? You and I should remember this date. 1989? Okay, so since 1989, this had been about 10 years when the young missionary I'm thinking of spoke to him. He said, since the wall fell, I have seen thousands face ridicule versus denying the name of Christ. And he said, I've seen very few who remain faithful to the through the ridicule. You can blow it off if you want to, but peer pressure is a difficult thing. And if you're following after Christ, you're going to get some peer pressure to get you doing the wrong thing. I'm going to say that one more time. If you're following after Christ, 12:15, and I promise I'm going to be done in a few minutes. But if you're following after Christ, you're going to get some peer pressure to do the wrong thing. And if you're not, you're probably not following after Christ. In 1 Corinthians 9, in 1 Kings 19, here's what we all do. And I've mentioned it several times lately. We all get this mindset that nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. The old silly song goes. That's what Elijah was feeling in 1 Kings 19. And he prayed to God and said, hey, I'm the only one you got left. But a few verses later, the Lord said, I have 7,000 that haven't bared the knee. You're not standing alone. If they persecuted Christ, just I'm only going to read one more, but that's the same verse recorded in two different Gospels, Jerusalem, which killeth the prophets and stonest them that are sent unto thee. This whole persecuting believers is not a new thing. Jesus said, how often I would have gathered thy children together as a hen doth gather her brood under her wings, and ye would not. There's unbelievable joy in persecution if you're being persecuted for righteousness' sake. There's joy in being talked about. That doesn't sound right, does it? It doesn't even sound right. There's joy in being propagandized. But again, the caveat is, if you are being talked about for his name's sake. They talked about Christ. Imagine this. Christ stopped the funeral. Jonah, have you ever been to a funeral? Have you ever seen the person in the casket get up and walk away? Jesus went to a funeral, and that's what happened. There was a woman, Cecile. She was she had an issue of blood. She was bleeding for years, like 12 years, the Bible records. And she had spent all of her money on doctors, and nothing would fix it. But Jesus did.
Amen.
There's a guy who couldn't see. Jesus fixed it. A guy who couldn't walk, and Jesus fixed it. All these different things that Christ did, and yet, for the sake of time, I'm just going to tell you what they called him. They called him a gluttonous man and a wine bibber because he ate with sinners. He just befriended sinners so he could lead them to himself, and he was propagandized. He was talked about. Just make sure if people are gossiping about you, they're gossiping about you because of your righteous life. And that starts with being saved. Amen. The final point, pampered. We may be persecuted here, but James 1:12 says there's a crown of life awaiting us. Revelation 2:10 verifies there's a crown of life awaiting us. Paul, when he was waiting to have his head chopped off, the time of my departure is at hand. You know, he had the same idea. A lot of times when we stand up for Christ, when we stand up for something that we believe in, and the persecution comes, we're real brave to start. Then towards the end, we begin to crumple. But I like the fact that the scripture records Paul had the same thought at the end that he had at the beginning. When he was first arrested, he said, to live is Christ, to die is gain. And right before they chopped his head off, he said, the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. He didn't say I fought well. He said I fought a good fight. He was doing the right thing. He wasn't bragging on himself. He was bragging on his Savior.
Amen.
I'm now ready to be offered. He had the same thought at the end as he had at the beginning. If I'm doing it for Christ, whatever comes, it's going to be for my good. There's a crown of righteousness awaiting him. Here's the thing. Maybe you're here this morning and you know that you're saved. Then you can take joy if your life lines up with these attitudes the Bible says we're supposed to have. But maybe you're listening by Facebook. Maybe you're here this morning and you're not sure. The Bible says in Jeremiah 8:20 that harvest is past, summer is ended, and we are not saved. Man, don't go on in your sin and in your rejection of Christ until that verse is true for you. What did Amos say? Amos said, prepare to meet thy God. Amos was not real different from me. Just a country boy. Just a herder. Just a gatherer. In other words, he was some kind of farmer. But he went and preached, prepare to meet thy God. This is serious. We need to remember God's word is forever settled in heaven.
Amen.
We need to remember we don't impress God with our prayers. In fact, he tells us as believers not to make much ado about our prayer life. In other words, don't pray on the corners were his exact words. Don't pray on the street corner out there to impress the passersby like the heathen do. We need to remember that our works don't impress God. Jesus said, many will come into me that day and say, Lord, Lord. Actually, he said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father. So what is the will of the Father this morning? You're here this morning. You don't know you have a home in heaven. You're unsure. Maybe you know mama did. Maybe you know daddy did, but you're not sure. Let me tell you what his will is that he wants you to do. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Exactly. It's very simple. You turn from your own way, and you turn to Christ. That's it. I mean, it could. That's why we call it God's simple plan of salvation. It's not a list of 100 things. Shall be saved. Ephesians says it's not by works. Titus says it's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy. My question for you this morning is the same question I started the children's message with. Do you know that you have a home in heaven? And if you don't, please talk to me at the close of the service. Let me take the word of God. Not what I think, not what Phil thinks, not what Jeremy thinks, but what Jesus thinks, and show you how you can know that you have eternal life. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads while the musicians come forward. Dear Heavenly Father, I do thank you for the privilege of preaching this morning. I pray that your will has been accomplished.